Brain matters. The wonderful flexibility of English means that could have several different connotations depending on exactly where you put it. What we're going to talk about today a little bit is the human brain and about some things that matter regarding the brain and our understanding of it. And in recent years, the tools that we've developed in the medical community and things to really understand what's going on in the brain are truly extraordinary. And we're going to get to those in a moment. Now, of course, people have been thinking about the brain and what goes on in our heads for a long time. And some ancient people used to cut people's heads open and look inside to see what was going on in there, and that didn't work out all that well. More recently, but not real recently, about 100 or a little bit more than 100 years ago, we started to get psychoanalysis and things, and people looking at what's going on in the brain and the way the mind works and things through psychology and through talking to people and understanding what makes them tick and things. And of course, as they're doing this, one of the things they're discovering at the same time through anthropology and through studies of cultures around the world is they're discovering that every human culture has religion. This is Rob McGivern, a senior lecturer in sociology and anthropology. And he says, religion is a cultural universal found in all social groups. Now, cultural universal just means it's a feature that you find in every culture, going back from the very beginning of humanity and history long ago to the current day and around the globe in every place. Wherever there are people, there are religious ideas, religious thought, and religious practices. Now, what those actually look like vary quite a lot between cultures, but they're always there. There are always ideas and thoughts about the afterlife and how do we handle the deceased body and stuff, and what do we think about that, and how do we relate to nature and the things around us, and some forms of prayer and things. These are in every language, every culture, everywhere. Every people has some form of these things. As a matter of fact, even in the Soviet Union, when they decided to eliminate religion and they were promoting communism as the answer for everything, one of the things that happened is they end up building the Tomb of Lenin right there in Moscow, and people all lined up to stop and pause in silence and bow before Lenin's corpse. And that actually became like a religious observance or a ritual of communism. So even when people try to suppress religion, it reappears in some form because it's a basic need in the human heart to worship and to relate to the world through an understanding that there is something greater than us and something beyond us. And how we work that out in different cultures has varied a lot, but it's always there. Now, I mentioned psychology, and everybody knows Freud, but we're going to skip right past Freud and go to Carl Jung. Now, Carl Jung was the founder of analytical psychology, and he originally studied with Freud and agreed with Freud about a lot of things, but then he broke away from Freud and he had his own ideas and his own theories, and he took quite a different course in a lot of things. Has anybody ever taken the Myers-Briggs personality type indicator test? Okay, well, you should give thanks to Carl Jung for that test. Myers and Briggs may have put the tests together, but it's all based on Carl Jung's understanding of personalities and things. What Myers and Briggs did is just develop a diagnostic test to look for these personality types. So that's the connection a lot of us have to Carl Jung, and he did a lot of other things as well. And some of his theories are no longer considered to be valid by current psychology and advances that they've made, but they underpin, his ideas underpin so much of even what goes on in psychology or even business management today is heavily underpinned by Carl Jung's ideas. Now, he said some interesting things. After all of his studies of personalities and things, he said the soul possesses by nature a religious function. Which means it's natural for us to have religious yearnings, religious feelings. It's a natural part of what it means to be human. And as a matter of fact, he did a lot of counseling and helping people with psychoanalysis and things. And he said, I treated many hundreds of patients. And he went on, he said, none of them has really been healed who did not regain his religious outlook. See, He felt that people are born and grow up as little children with a religious outlook, that children are naturally religious, children naturally believe in God. But somehow, in the process of society, sometimes that's pushed out. But when people come in and they're having troubles in life, they don't get healed of their difficulties and things without regaining that religious outlook in some form. And that was one of his basic ideas about how religion and society function. Now, that doesn't mean that everybody who's non-religious has psychological problems. That's not what I'm saying. But of the people that he treated and that he saw that came to him for help, those who had lost a religious perspective on the world had to regain it before they were able to come to a new type of psychological health. Now, today, this is all about 100 years ago, his work and things. Today, we've gotten very medically oriented and scientific about so much of what's going on. As a matter of fact, even the field of psychology is looking more and more to medicine in order to integrate the understanding of what goes on in the human mind and the brain. We have magnetic resonance imaging, which allows us for the first time to really take good pictures of what's going on inside your head. I don't know whether you've ever had an MIR of your brain. I have not. Some people here have, I see. But they can produce these wonderful color-coded pictures. They use pseudo-color that they add to it, and they can get pictures of the structure of your brain and what's going on and whether everything's working right in there, and they can see it very clearly. Of course, for a long time, we've been developing what's called brain mapping. It's sort of what's the geography of the brain and towards where in your head do different things happen, you know? And so they've been studying it for a long time. They can tell you exactly what part of your brain is involved in your hearing being processed or your eyesight or in moving your hand. And then as they came along, they began to ask the question, is there a God spot in the human brain? Well, that's an interesting way of putting it. But is there a spot in the brain that's responsible for whether we believe in God or not for our religious outlook and these things? And the work has been done in this area quite extensively, actually, and they're doing more. And they've come to the conclusion there is not one God spot, but there are many spots in the brain involved with people's ideas of faith and religion and things and their reactions to it, especially two or three that are very key. Now, they went on from doing MRIs to doing what's called functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRIs, which is where they're testing what's going on in your head related to a particular thought or idea or feeling or action. So they'll tell you, you know, okay, you're laying here and you're going to get your MRI done and say, okay, what we want you to do is we want you to just meditate or pray or think about a particular thing and see what that does inside your head. What's going on in there when you do this? And they take an fMRI. And then they got even more sophisticated, and now we do it in 3D with what's called an SPECT, a single photon emission computed tomography of your brain. And we can do that of your whole body. This is a whole body of a mouse here scanned, you know, to see what's going on inside that. And they can get much higher resolution and dig right down into your brain and see what's going on. So we have some really good tools now, medically speaking, to see what's going on inside people's heads. Oh, I'm sure that sometimes you've been with somebody and they said something and you thought, what's going on in their head right now? Especially if you're married, you know, your spouse, you know, what's going on in her head? You know, we think that every now and then, trying to understand each other and where we're coming from. It's not always negative. Sometimes it's a very good thing. But now we can get pictures and we can draw diagrams and we can show you what went on in terms of electrical impulses in your brain, at least. You know, what's going on in that neural cortex? Now, one of the things they did in this religious studies is we've got this guy, Brick Johnston, a whole team of people, and what they were actually doing is verifying things that other people had found before them. So they're like the second look to make sure that the conclusions of somebody else were actually correct in this particular study. One of the things they find is that the right parietal lobe of the brain is associated with increased spiritual transcendence. Specifically, decreased function in your right parietal lobe is associated very closely with people who have a sort of feeling of oneness with the world, a feeling of God's presence, a feeling of being one with God, these sorts of deep, sort of transcendent feelings and functions in a person's mind are associated with shutting down this part of the brain. Well, physiologically, this makes a lot of sense because this part of the brain is the part that processes your contact with the external world. When you touch something or see something, it all goes into here and gets sorted out to be told your conscious brain what's going on. So if you start to decrease the function here, you don't feel the world around you as much, and you feel more internally or a sense of unity with something bigger than you. And then they've also found that in the frontal lobe, there's an area that's associated with increased religiosity. The people who go to temple or church, who pray, who meditate, who are involved in a lot of religious activities of one kind or another, are much more developed in their frontal lobe. And they actually have thicker layers here, if they've been involved in it for a long time, that can be detected, that have been developed. So that raises a lot of questions. And this effort to match the spiritual part of the geography of the brain is continuing. And it brings in a lot of questions to science and to religious people as well. You know, what's exactly going on here? Well, this gal here has kind of put it together, Sarah Lane Ritchie, a research fellow in theology and science. And she's kind of put together into what do we know and what do we not know in some of her presentations. And you can find some of her stuff on YouTube as well. And she says, we know that the neural cortex activity can be monitored. It's related to religious feelings and activities. We know that belief is not non-physical. You know, people think that what they believe about God or their faith is completely non-physical and not related to their body. But we know that's not actually so. It's actually deeply connected to the brain, the body, and even the environment around you is connected to the things you believe. We know that religious activities such as prayer and meditation cause changes in the brain. That they did studies on both Catholic nuns and on Buddhist monks in prayer and meditation and looked at this. And you can actually see these people developing the parts of their brain that are involved in religious activities. Now, what are the things we don't know? We don't know whether there's any causal relationship. You know, these religious feelings or activities are associated with certain types of brain activity, but we don't know, is there a causal relationship? Does the brain somehow create the sense that God is real, leading to belief? Or do real experiences with God cause specific types of brain activity? And they ask, you know, people are asking, does evolutionary development of religious belief disprove the validity of religious belief? As they look back and they see that these ideas of these parts of the brain and stuff, you know, developed at some point in history, they say, well, does that prove that religious beliefs are nothing but some physical function that was developed? Or does it actually prove that God intended and planned for us to be religious? And that we develop these areas of the brain because that was what God intended in his creation, in his planning? We don't know these things, Sarah tells us. So here's a question. We know there's this correlation or association between religious experience and activities and the level of activity in certain regions of the brain. What do you think it means? Does it mean that the brain activity causes religion, belief in God? Or does it mean that religious activity and belief cause that brain activity? Or does it mean that something else is causing both the brain activity and the religious beliefs? What do you think? I think, you know, there could be a lot of different opinions about this. But our opinions or thoughts about this are largely driven by our assumptions that we already hold. For people who have a very non-religious assumption about the world to begin with, they're going to think probably that the brain activity simply causes religious belief and that it's nothing more than a response to this physiology of the mind and that it's not real. However, people who come from a different background, who have a more favorable assumption about religion or who have their own strong beliefs or faith, are going to look at it differently. Now, myself, I think C is the answer I would choose. Something else causes both the brain activity and the religious activity and beliefs. And in my opinion, that something else, in my experience and understanding, is God. When we have real contact with God, it causes a lot of different things to happen. And it's perfectly natural that those things would happen in our body and in our mind, in our brain activity, as well as in our lifestyle and other things, because they're driven by the reality of God's presence and activity. That's where I'm at and what I feel about it. And it adds up with Scripture pretty well. In the Bible, in Psalm 139, verses 14 to 16, it says, "I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." Now, here we have a psalmist who's writing long ago, you know, thousands of years ago, at least 1,500 or more years ago, and he's saying that all of this is according to God's plan. And if we have these physical reactions in our brain, well, that's part of God's plan. That's part of God's design for us. And I agree. I feel that that's very true. That's where I'm at, my own position as well. But I would ask another question. One of the things we have with these activities that science tries to investigate, religion and stuff, is they tend to assume in these scientific studies of religion that all religions are basically one phenomenon, that there's a religious phenomenon, and that that religious phenomenon is one thing expressed in different ways in different cultures. And so they treat it as one phenomenon when they try to investigate it or look at it. But is this approach valid? Can we really say that all the different sets of beliefs in different cultures and things are really just one religious phenomenon? And do these brain tests and brain scans and other psychological studies and just mix people of completely different religious beliefs all together in these studies just because they're religious and see that as one thing? Or do we need to look at things a little bit more carefully and divide out what are their beliefs and why do they hold those beliefs and think about that? Many Christians strongly emphasize that the heart of Christianity is relationship, not religion. So perhaps researchers should respect that and they should treat Christian belief as a relationship instead of a religious activity and look at Christian belief in terms of how Christian belief affects the brain the same way your relationships with your parents or your spouse or your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your people around you, your children. Look at it in terms of relationship maybe instead of in terms of quote religious belief and activity. Instead of in terms of just feelings and activities, look at it as a relationship and see where that research goes. As far as I know, that hasn't been done yet. So far, the studies that I've heard of anyway have all looked at all of religions as one phenomenon. Let's go back to our old friend Carl Jung for a few minutes and take a note of something that he says. I mentioned this about relationships. Look at what Carl says. "The meeting of two personalities is like the contact of two chemical substances. If there is any reaction, both are transformed." That's an interesting statement. When we think of religion, we don't expect this kind of transformation of both personalities coming and meeting, so to speak. But that would be involved in relationship from Carl's research and studies. You know, in the case of Christianity, meeting Jesus would change us and perhaps would somehow change Jesus as well as he develops a relationship with yet another person who's trusting in him. Let's take a look at another thing Carl says. Carl Jung's father was actually a pastor, but his father came to a point in the influences of that time and age and everything that was going on where his father was really kind of lost his faith and trust in God and was kind of going through the motions. And young Carl, as a child, really noticed this and was impacted by it. But later on, he said, concerning his father, he said, he did not know the immediate living God who stands omnipotent and free above his Bible and his church, who calls upon man to partake of his freedom. In other words, Carl, having had a direct experience with God that he felt he had had, believed that his father was doing religious activities, but that his father didn't actually know the living God. And that's kind of what happens a lot with religion. It happens in Christian churches as well, even a pastor in this case. Some people are going through the motions of religion, and they're doing all the activities, and maybe they even have religious feelings and emotional experiences, but they don't know the living God. And yet, if we look at the New Testament and the Bible especially, the heart of Christianity is knowing the living God through Jesus Christ. Look at some of the things that Jesus says. Jesus says here in John 8, 35 and 36, he says, now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Now, I wouldn't want to take this analogy too far, but you know, in some ways, being very religious can be a little bit like slavery. So many things you have to do, so many things you're not allowed to do. It can start to feel very constricting and very binding to be a very religious person in terms of your activities and your lifestyle. But how different is an actual relationship with God, where Jesus says, if the Son, that's Jesus, sets you free, you are free indeed. And then look at what Jesus says in John 14. He says, Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Again, notice that the heart of this is about relationship, about knowing Jesus, knowing God the Father. It's not really saying a lot about religious activities or even about emotional experiences. All of those can be good things. But real faith begins with a relationship with Jesus. And Jesus Christ hasn't changed. That was 2,000 years ago he said that. But he said Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, it tells us in Hebrews. And that's the witness of the church, that we may change, but Jesus does not change, and he's still available to each and every one of us in the same way. Let's close with this idea here. 1 John 3:1, the Apostle John's writing, he says, how great is the love the Father God, has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Again, relationship. So I'm really hoping that the people who are doing these studies and things will come to a point one day where they wake up and say, gee, we should look at Christianity in terms of relationship, but not just in terms of religion in our study. It'd be interesting to see what they find. The tools of science are very valuable and helpful to us in so many ways. And they can help us to grow in our understanding of the world and even in our understanding of faith. Thank you. Let's close with a word of prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this day and for the wonderful blessings you give us, both through the revelation in your creation that we view through science to learn how things work, and through your word where we learn to have a relationship with you. Bless each and every one in the name of Jesus. Amen.